All right, so I guess everyone can hear me. So we'll be learning today how to make responsive designs. Do you understand? With Figma. Okay, so what I mean by that is that you should be able to create something like this. Okay, you should be able to create something like this. You can see how responsive this is. And then we have the same thing for this. You should be able to create something like this also. So quickly, we are going to consider how to, you know, create auto layouts and also the constraints and resizing everything. You're going to learn them this in the next 30 minutes, okay? And if you have more questions, you can always ask me. But for now, you have to just listen attentively. If you have notes and you want to jot things down, please jot them down, right? If you have any question, please type them on the chat, okay? I will read it out. And I'll answer you. Okay, please don't unmute yourself unless I call you. All right, so let's get started. So first of all, right? So what is AutoLayout? AutoLayout basically is auto arrangement of elements in a frame. Okay, when you automatically arrange something in a frame, okay. Then another thing about auto layout is that it helps us to create a design system that will be used for a project. Do you understand? So you can create a design system for your button. It's going to be automatically responding your cards and e-commerce card, Instagram card, contact card, WhatsApp cards, you know, all these things that you mostly be using repeatedly. You can quickly fix them first of all in your design system before you now start making use of them. Right, so let's create something ASAP. So we have had so many times that when we want to create a button, for example, we should not use a rectangle. Okay, I'm talking about something like this. Let's say we have submit. So let's say this is our official, what is it called? This is our button. Okay, so we want to have probably from your design, from your style guide, okay? And then you do something like this. So right, so basically, most of you have been creating buttons like this, whereby you have this rectangle and then you have this submit, and then you group them, something like that. You just Ctrl G or you group selection them. Yeah, so we've advised designers not to do something like this, okay, because it's not proper. Basically, it's not going to help your design system, okay? It's not going to help your design system, and it's not also responsive, okay? So what will make sense is that naturally we've advised that probably you should be creating you should create your buttons with what they call a frame, okay? So this is a frame, and then you can write whatever you want to write in it, maybe like the submit. And then you can use, because of you're using a frame, okay, you can use this function, okay, you can use this orientation function. Okay, you can put it in the center. You can also align it like vertically and horizontally, you understand? So that makes it stay in the middle, and then you can give it a color. You can also style the frame, okay, and then you can style the frame anyhow that you want it. And you can see we are creating almost the same thing, but one is actually responsive. One is normal than the other, if you get what I mean. So yeah, so this is supposedly the type of buttons we are supposed to be creating, okay? But in a way, because you want to do something very unique, something very clean, okay? I wouldn't advise you again not to use this type. And so if you want to create a button, what would I have advised you to do is that you write your submit singularly. Okay, sorry, that's submit. And then once you do this, you click on it and then you turn it to an auto layout. Okay, how do you do that? Shift A or you right click, then you see this add auto layout. Now it's going to create this frame for you. The same frame that we are having here, it should be creating something like that for you. In fact, you can expand it. You can also style it the way you styled the one at the top. Okay. if that's the case. But before you start expanding it, we want to go a little bit technical because we're working with developers, right? Developers need figures. They need, okay, what is the pixel size that I use? What is the padding size and things like that, okay? Now, if you notice when I was drawing out this and when I was drawing this also, I did not mention anything like padding. I did not mention anything like resizing and stuff. I didn't mention even pixel, okay? This is me drawing things manually. Anybody can come here and create this. But the difference between this one and this one is two things. First of all, if you look at this if you look at this frame, okay, both of them are frame. Like I said, we are not creating buttons with groups. So normally you are supposed to delete this. We are concerned with this frame, creating components or creating elements or your design system with frames. Do you understand? So you see that difference between this one and this one is this thumbnail that describes them. Okay, you see this. Two boxes. Okay, it looks like this, right? So we have the one that look like this. Okay, something like this, right? So this is one type of frame. Okay, this frame that I'm looking at, you can see it here. And then we have this type. This one is nested. Okay, they call it this type of frame. Okay, these ones that you usually get your iPhone, your desktop, your tablet, presets. Do you understand? So we have the second one, which is like this, like this. So this is what you should really pay attention. If you know this, there's a big chance you don't have any problem with auto layout anyway. So if I duplicate this now and probably change this to 90 degrees, something. Okay, so we have this. So this is the nested version of a frame. Okay, both of them are frames, but this is the nested version of it. So the difference between this type of frame and this type of frame, number one is the name. This one is gotten from auto layout, and this one is gotten from the nested version, which is the one you can easily create yourself manually. Okay, then secondly, another difference is that this frame does not have any setting here per se. You don't see any other extra setting. The only thing you are seeing here is the orientation. And you are seeing the frame setting, that's the where it will be on the x-axis, y-axis, the width, the height, blah, 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 and then the colors, okay? But for this frame, the one that we got from auto layout, you'll be seeing this auto layout setting, and then you'll be seeing resizing setting. That's the difference between the two. Okay, I hope you guys understand now. Do you understand? So that is why naturally there is one that is more advanced than the other, or there's one that is more technical than the other. Okay, there is one that will perform the auto layout function than the other. You understand? So most likely it is best to go with something like this. Now, I'm most likely going to create the same thing we created from this. I'm going to use this one to create, but this time I'll be using figures and I'll be using auto layout setting. Okay, so look at this now. For example, we have the width is 462, and then what is inside, okay, is 63. Okay, then there's another thing you could do, but now I want to see what is the size, the pixel size between the edge and the element itself. Okay, they are called padding. See those spaces, this spacing, this spacing between here and here, then the spacing between here and here, they are called padding. You understand? So if you hold your alt, okay, you will see it. You can see that from the left, it is 200, the top is 32, the below is 32, and then the right hand side is 199. Do you understand? So basically, this is your figures, this is your padding setting for this button. So I guess the reason why this one is 200 and this one is 199 is because probably the width is an odd number. So if I probably change this to, actually, it's not even an odd number. So that is why it's very, very important that you use padding, because some of these things will not be accurate. You understand? So let's go to our auto layout type of thing. So first of all, our auto layout needs a color. I'm going to give this a color. I'm going to give this the white color, right? Now, the next thing is that in the auto layout setting, okay, this is my padding. So the padding around the items, this is the setting. Okay, this is the padding. You can give it any figure. If you want everything, maybe the whole maybe the whole padding areas, you want it to be 10, okay? Now, if you zoom in, you will notice that if I hold my Alt, everything here is 10, 10, 10, and 10, okay? Which, this is why everything here is 10. But if you want to do it like manually, you want to write them one after the other, okay? Just like we have from this area, we have, I think this one is called 32, 32, 200, 200. So I can do it here. Just click here and then, so you click the frame and then you click something like this is 32, and then 200 and of course 200. Now you see that I have created the same version of this button with the auto layouts. Okay, and now you can see that this one is very technical and this one is very, don't let us use the word responsive yet, right? This is the ability for use auto layouts and this is the ability for use padding. If you go on website, right, and then you are probably looking out for inspect elements on a website, you'll be seeing some of these things, you'll be seeing paddings a lot of times like that. So let's go, let's be fast, right? Now, if I keep typing things, because of the setting that I've done, I've made settings that anything I type, right, it should maintain the 200 pixels, the left and right hand side, okay? So that means if I type, this is the name, okay, okay? Because of the setting that I've made, the whole thing is still responsive. You can see that everything is still correct, okay? But if I write the same thing here, this thing is the new, is the new, click here, you can see that it's not responding, okay? It's not responsive per se. You can see this is the difference between an auto layout and an ordinary frame, okay? So normally we used to advise designer that they should stick with this, okay, so that you can do even more advanced settings for your buttons or for your whatever thing you are designing for, right? Do you guys understand? If you understand, please let me know. Just type maybe to this point, if you know you are getting it or you've learned something new, just let me know, okay? Should we move on? All right, so let us move on, right? Now, it's even very, very possible that we can make this one also responsive. It's just that its own responsiveness is a little bit different. Its own responsiveness is what is different. Its own responsiveness is concerned with the things that are inside of it. What do I mean by that? So let me undo some of the text I've written. Okay, let's go back to submit. Okay, so if you want this frame to be responsive, okay, because it doesn't have its own setting, its own setting is inside the elements that are inside it. Okay, this is the one that has the setting. You can see it has the constraint setting. Okay, this one setting is called resizing. Why this one setting is called constraints. So the nested frame, the element inside the nested frame is constraints. Why the element inside an auto layout frame is resizing. Do you understand? Yes, I hope you understand. So if you look at the text inside or the element inside the nested frame, you can make settings of it. What that means is that you can see that anytime your auger, which is the frame, which is this guy, anytime your auger is drawing to the left, follow it. Anytime your auger is drawing from the right, follow it. If it's drawing from the top, follow it. If it's drawing from the right and from the bottom, follow it. So what does that mean? I can set this guy, what is inside, I can set it toward left and right. So basically, if I start to pull this frame, which is the auger, if I start to pull it, this one will become responsive. Now, the reason why you're not seeing this is because it's actually responsive, but it's at the left-hand side. But did you see the size of my text box now? You can see that stretched. If I reduce it, you're going to see it now. You can see that it has come back. Okay, so let's do something else so that it will make more sense so that you can probably understand better. So let's put this in the center. Let's put this text, our text, let's put it in the center. Now let's pull this. Did you see now? You see how responsive it is? It's following it because of that's how I dragged. Okay. So that is that on that. Change this back to. All right, so that is how this responsiveness works. Now, let us try another style so that you understand. So, but let's say we've added, let's remove this, for example, probably let's take this off. Let's put maybe a rectangle shape inside it. Okay, let's use maybe this color, you understand? So, and I'm going to set, like I said, what has the setting at the element inside of it? Okay. Is those ones that have the constraint setting. So you can set this one to like left and right. Okay. So what that means is that when you pull this, you can say that this one follows it. It responds with it. Do you understand? That's what I'm trying to say. So this one is constraint. Why this one is resize? Okay. So another setting we can do now is that the same function of this, we can also do it for this frame. In fact, that's why auto layout frame is even more diverse to get. It has more setting. So let's do it this way. Let's say we want this one to always stay in the middle anytime we pull this auto layout frame. So what I'm going to do is that I'm going to click here and I'm going to put it in the center. Understand? So what that means is that when I pull this, it stays in the middle, okay? You can see the way it is. This is how it goes. Now, let's do more practice. Do you guys understand the two things that the difference between the two? Who is saying she doesn't understand? Which part do you not understand? Can you type it? But do other people, do you understand? Do you see the difference between the two? Okay. Please let me know if you understand. Let everybody say they understand. If they understand, please type. So I can continue and we can deal with the person that doesn't understand so I can come again. Okay, so the person that says she doesn't understand, can she type what she means so that I can come over it again and talk about it? Okay, I said unnested frames, please. Hope it's not that you're just joining the class, so you don't drag us back, because I said this class is going to end in 30 minutes. So I said for nested frame, this type of frame, anything that is inside will be the one having the constraint setting. So what that means is that you can set it that when they are pulling the frame, the bigger frame that you belong to, or the ones that you are inside, when they are pulling you from the left or the right, respond with it. That's what it means. Okay. So if you do something like this, okay, when you're pulling from the right, that is the only time you should respond. When they are pulling from the left, don't respond. This is what it means. You can see when I pull from the left, it's not responding. When I'm pulling from the right, it's responding. Do you understand now? So that's the meaning of nested constraints or the settings on nested constraints. Okay. But if I decide to tell this guy that when they are, okay, like let's do top and bottom. Okay. Let's do center, for example. So I want to set this thing that if they are pulling from the bottom or they are pulling from the top, stay in the center, okay? So when you pull it down, you can see that it's staying in the center. No matter where you pull it to, it's going to keep staying in the center. It's not going to pass the center, okay? That is what constraint means. Please, why are you raising your hands? Do you understand now? All right, so let's continue. Now, the setting we did here, we can also do it for auto layout setting, okay? But its own is just very simple. So you can do the element inside this auto layout frame should stay at the center when resizing. So this is what I mean, okay? You can see when I'm pulling from the top, it's also at the center. Now I'm pulling from the bottom, it's also at the center. You can see that, okay, my element should stay at the left center, okay? So what I mean is that if let's put it there. So what I mean is that if I'm pulling, it should stay at the left. You can see it's staying at the left center. Don't forget the padding is the one that is making the whole thing look big. So you can see I'm pulling from the left center. Okay. If I decide to say stay at the right bottom, you can see. If I decide to say stay at the up, the top right, you can see. If I say you should stay here. So if you're creating your design system, most likely your buttons is going to be like in the middle, or it's going to be here, or it's going to be here, wherever it's going to be. Okay. But when your frame is resizing, it's going to stick to the plan. Do you see the difference now? Do you guys understand what I just explained? Okay. For auto layout, you do your constraint stuff. You do it in this box. But for a nested frame, you do the setting with the element that is inside. You pick the one that you want. If you want it to be at the left or center, or you should scale when you're dragging the frame. Do we understand? Yes. So let's quickly design an app ASAP. So I'm going to create this, let's say an iPhone X. So I have an iPhone X now. So the first thing I'm going to do now is that I'm going to check my assets. There are some icons I just designed. So I'm going to pull them in, probably pull this in, and maybe I'll be using this. So these four are going to be my official footer, maybe for the app I want to build. So let me zoom in so that you can see things properly. Okay, so the next thing I want to do now is that I'm going to write the names. I'm going to write hard, probably two, and then maybe locate, and then probably I'll be using profile. Okay, now the next thing I want to do now is that these two, because they're going to be a button. Okay, obviously, that's something I'm going to press, right? I'm going to turn off them to auto layout. So this one will be auto layout. Okay, this one will be auto layout. This also will be auto layout. And also this will be auto layout. So now I have auto layout, four of them. Now, did you notice that all of them had the right button? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put all of them at the center. Do you understand now? I'm going to put everything here at the center. Okay. Put everything here at the center. Put it at the center. Okay. Now you can decide to see the spacing between this and this is currently 11. It's currently 11 pixels. Okay. So you can change this to 0, or maybe you can change it to 4, depending on your spacing that you have introduced in your design system. So let's assume that I've decided that anytime I'm using a spacing in my buttons, I want it to be in 4. So I want to use 4 pixels for all my buttons. So I'm going to do something like this. It's going to be 4. This one also will be 4. This one also will be 4. Okay, so when I'm done with this, okay, I want to do something like, okay, I want the padding around each of the buttons to be in 2. So I want to put 2 pixels around the padding. Okay, so I'm going to create something like this. Put 2 padding, okay. Put 2 padding also here, and also 2 padding here. Okay, so now that I've done that, okay, I can decide to start designing the probably. I want to give you some kind of like styling. Okay, that means I want to give all of them. I want all of them to have something like, you should have something like a white background. Okay. Then probably the next thing I want to probably do is that I'm trying to give this color for now so that you can see what is inside. Okay, because there are some things I'll be doing now that you need to see the weight of the probably the width or the height of the button. So the next thing I want to do now is that because of these sizes are different widths, you can see that this one is 41, this one is 66, this one is 66, and this one is 62. So you can see they are not consistent. So what I'm going to do now is that I'm going to give all of them a manual button size. So I can probably, when you notice that Figma deactivates or make the width and height it kind of maybe it deactivates it. It's because of you've been working with AutoLayout, so they don't want you to drag it or pull something up or something like that. Normally, if you want to increase this, the width of this, all you just have to do is to probably set your padding. So maybe you want to be using maybe 10 at the left and probably 10 at the right, something like that. Okay, that should make your button. But in this case, we want to give it a kind of like manual width and height. So okay, I think this one is the highest, this 66. So I want to make this 66. So you can pull this and just type maybe 66 here. Okay, and for this one also, pull this a bit so that they can allow you to edit and change it to 66. Now, all the buttons here are of the same size. Okay, you can see that Figma has deactivated it again. Now, when you have done all these things, and you can see everything now is the padding is 2, and then the spacing between the text and the icons are 4. You can see you're creating a system that everybody else has to follow, whether the developer or the junior designer or the senior designer, whosoever you'll be collaborating with, they already have that rule. The next thing you want to do is that because all these things are now a navbar, you can probably take off the color. You understand? So you can now auto layout everything. Just add under auto layout shift A, and then they become what, a single frame. Do you understand now? Now this makes sense. Okay. Now don't forget that what we've been doing is still this auto layout frame. All right. So the next thing now is that most likely I'll probably now give this whole thing some colors, right? So let's give it some colors. Let's use this. Okay. Probably we can edit it. We can probably give this 20. And then this one also maybe 20. Okay, then you want to give it some kind of like padding so that they can have spaces. So you could probably put 10. And now it's looking very, very nice. So instead of it drawing those frames yourself, you can use auto layout to fix all this. Now, the next thing you want to do now is that you want to change, because this is going to be your official footer. Okay, this is most likely going to be your official footer. The next, and obviously, let's say you want to add more things in future. Let's say you want to add more, anybody is asking you that you want to, probably don't want to add more things. You can see that everything now is becoming responsive and everything is automatic. Okay. If you remove any elements, it's going to be automatic. You can see the way it's very, very responsive. Okay. So the next thing you want to do now is that if you click on this, this is having the resize setting. Do you understand? It's having the resize setting. It's currently hogging the content. So that means the more things you put inside, the more it expands. The more things you put inside, it will hog the content. Okay. But if you say, I want it to be fixed, no matter what I put inside this thing, the button, the footer should remain the same. The width of the footer should remain the same. So that means if I click on this profile and I duplicate it, you can see that this guy is not expanding with them. This guy is not expanding. He's not expanding with them. Okay. Everything now is outside the frame. Do you understand? Because I've set this frame to be fixed. But if I decide to say, bros, hug everything that is inside you, hug all this content, or hug everything, it's going to hug it. Does that make any sense? Do you guys understand that part? Yes, I hope you do. Okay. The same thing. So let's say we have 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, let's add one more thing. But let's say we have 1, 2, 3, and 4. Okay, we want to put them inside one, like we want to group them. Maybe we want to group them, right? So you can what, add auto layout to them. Okay, they will become one. Okay, then you can take this remaining 4 and what, add under auto layout. So this auto layout, this big guy, is now governing 2 elements, which is this first one and the second one. Now you can take this big guy that instead of it going to the horizontal aspect, it should come vertically. Does that make sense now? So you can see now it's coming vertical. Okay. And now your vertical states that anytime they are adding more elements, the thing should keep hugging to it. So that means if I add more things, this thing will be going down and down. Do you guys understand that part? Yes, I hope so. So let's delete this, okay? And let's store this thing back to what? Horizon. Let's talk it back to the direction that we want it to go. All right, so when you do all these things, right, the next thing you want to do now is that you want to make sure that this thing is what? Automatic. Okay, before we do that, let's pull our footer inside our app. So you can see. Now, did you see that this thing is not fitting to the iPhone? You can say it doesn't fit to the iPhone. Do you get my point? It doesn't fit. It's too big. Okay, so that means something must be wrong in our calculation. Okay, so what we can do now is that we can just make this, just click on this main auto layout, this guy, just change it to, sorry, Control Z. I've pressed something else. Okay, so you can just click on this guy, this one that is housing everybody, click on it and change it from packed, change it to what? Space between. So when you make this thing space between, so you're trying to tell Figma that this thing will be what? Automatic. Okay, it creates a kind of like automatic spacing between the layers. When they are stretched, you can see now they are automatically placed. Did you see that? Okay, so this makes a lot of sense. Then secondly, you know, this is another auto layout stuff. So you can say, okay, guys, I want you to fill the container. That's another function. It's called fill container. So that means I want these guys, these ones are inside. I want you to fill this container, this big frame here. I want you to fill it. So once I click on that, it's going to extend to the end. You see the way it extends to the end. And now look at the setting of our stuff. We said this thing should be at the top left. At the top right. So you can put that one. You can say, please, all of you should stay in the middle of the container. And it's going to be in the middle of the container. Does that make sense now? Does this make sense? Yes, I hope it does. Now you can see this is 34 spacing. I'll be 64 spacing. Okay. But because you want to make sure that this thing is automatically arranged by Figma, you don't want to be the one touching it. You can change this from packed to space between. And now this whole thing is now responsive. You can see how responsive it is. Okay. So each of the frame that you create for yourself has its own setting. First of all, this setting states that anytime this thing is working, it should probably hug the container. Okay. So that's one. Anytime we are adding more things, hug it. Let me delete some. You can see anytime we are adding more things, hug it. That's what we've commanded this one to state. Okay. Then we kind of added that this guy here should be the one to what can use all container. And then you now say that let's put this inside here now. Okay, and then we can decide to pull them close. Let me set it again. Please, if you get to a point and you're confused, let me know so I can come over again. Space between. Okay. This one also space between. Okay. Okay, this one will be fill container. All right, so we should have a full responsive footer. Now I can decide to pull this inside my design. Okay, and I can do something like this. Did you see now? Now I told you that any element that is inside this nested frame has a power to set constraints. Do you understand? So now it has the power to set constraints. So now, you know, naturally, this type of frame has resize power. So now that you're adding constraint to it, it now becomes constraint and resize. So you can change this and tell that when the Ogapatapata frame, the nested frame is being pulled from the left or from the right, follow with it. And when it is being pulled from the top to the left, stick to the bottom. You can say something like that, that should stick to the bottom. So when you are pulling, it's responsive. And when you are pulling from the bottom, it sticks to the bottom. If you are pulling from the top also, it sticks to the bottom. If you are pulling from the side, it becomes responsive. Okay. And now you have a full responsive UI. So if you notice, if I zoom in now and I change this to iPhone 13, it's going to be responsive. If I change this to iPhone 11, it's going to be responsive. If I even change it to iPad mini, it's going to be responsive. If I change this to desktop, it's going to be responsive. Anything you want to create will become responsive, okay? And that is how to make responsive interface, okay? Does it make sense? Don't forget, the element that are inside here has the constraint power, okay? And the element, the frame itself, this whole frame has resizing power. Do you guys understand? So that is how to create all these things. Now see, it's not as tough as you think. Okay. Now, if I go back to my tweet card that I designed, okay. Now we can let's pieces them one after the other. The first thing we did is that these two is one auto layout. Then these two is another auto layout. Okay. Then between this and this, then we have another auto layout. Just be looking at this side so that you can get what I'm saying. Okay. So these three, everything here has the space between setting. Okay. So this three itself is responsive. Okay. So what you just do now is that naturally, because you have manually pulled this thing, it becomes fixed width. So just change this to what? Fill the container. So anytime any container, which is any frame, is being adjusted, fill it, continue filling with it. Okay. Then the next one is this text. You can see this text also has filled the container. Does that make any sense? So that anytime they pull, it's going to what? Follow alongside. So just change this also to fill container. So you can see this container that is holding both the name and the tweet, both of them are now responsive to whatever container is dragging with them. Okay. Secondly, this image is also auto layout. Okay. This image is also what? It's also an auto layout. Come in, let me try and find it. Okay, so this image is also an auto layout, if you notice. Okay, and I opened it, I said it should fill the container both from the top and from the bottom so that when you pull, you can see it's going to be responsive. And also when you pull, the picture itself is also filling the container of its frame. Okay, then the next one is the tweets. Now, for this one that is inside, we have the rectangle and the text. So this rectangle, that's the line, and then the text. The text also has a lot of elements that are inside. Okay, we have the Twitter for phone, we have the dots, we have the time, we have the dots, and then we have this. Okay, now I set this one to be packed because I always want it to be at the left. Okay, if you turn this to space between, it will stretch across, it will stretch across the container, but that's not what I want. I want it to stay at left hand side. The same thing I did here, I want everything here to stick to the left hand side, but it should be in the middle. Okay. And now everything here has been set to what? To fill the container and also to respond. Do you understand now? Now, this old party, this old guy is a servant to the main nested frame. So this one is the one having the constraint. So I've set it that you should pull from the left when they are pulling from the left and from the right. Okay. And it should stick at the top when they are pulling vertically. Okay. So by the time we decide to pull from the top, it's going to stick to the top. And then when we are pulling from the bottom, it's going to stick to the bottom. You can see when you are pulling from the left, like we said here, stick to the left. And when you are pulling from the, when you are pulling from the left and right, respond with it. And that is how you make a responsive card. Do you guys understand? So I can release you to go and watch your ball. Do you guys understand how to make responsive layouts now? So if you want to test this, okay, create a WhatsApp. I have a, I think there was one WhatsApp. What is it that I created? You can create a WhatsApp. What is it called? You can create a WhatsApp. What did they call this thing? WhatsApp interface. So of course, we already have this guy. This guy is going to be our component because we'll be making use of him. It's going to be our component. So what I'm going to do is that I'm going to change this to component. I just pull this, okay? Then the next thing I will do is that I'm going to change this. I'm going to duplicate it. So one thing I used to tell my students is that I always make two type of components. The first one, which is the master component. And then the second one, which is going to be the secondary sub-component. So this one, I'm going to change it also to another component. Now this one is going to be the one that has a lot of variants. Okay, I'm going to create variant one and variant three types of variants. Okay, so in your design, you can do something like this. You can say anytime they click on add, every other one should go, they should go something like maybe 30% in opacity. Okay, anytime they click on cancel, these three should go 30% in opacity. And anytime they click on location, these three should go 30% in opacity. And also for this three should go 30% in opacity. Okay. And then another thing you could do is probably rename it, call this hard. All these cancel, all these locate, and call this. Oh, this is supposed to be profile. So let me set it again. Okay, let's change this to 30 and change this to 100. All right, so now that we have this, okay. Another thing is that I've made my assets. So my asset has combination of, I think the variant, there are so many variants I attached, fill and all. So I'm going to change this one to this, my variant here. Okay. This guy, I'm going to change it to fill. For my cancel, I'm going to change it to fill. And from my locate, I'll change it to fill. And from my profile, I'll change this to fill. Okay, so don't forget, I've set all these things from the iconography that I designed. Do you understand? So if you, in case you are wondering how I got all these things, it's because of I designed some icons and I made two versions of it. Okay, I turned all of them to components and variants. Okay, so this is a component, this is a variant, the component of all these things, so that anytime they feature, I can easily switch between fill and outline. Okay, now I usually advise designers that your what is it called? Okay, so let's say we are bringing in this guy. I'm bringing in this guy here. Put him in the center, we put him at the bottom. And don't forget, because it has constraint and size also, we change it. Now, if you notice that the, what is it called? If you notice that Figma do not allow you to switch between left and right, okay? What you just have to do is to shift it a bit and probably pull it back, okay? So that it will allow you to activate it back to you. You create, you click on left and right, okay? So that you can also, you can be able to set, be responsive with your design. Okay, come in, let me make sure that is good. Okay, let me go back to the components, because this guy has all the settings. This guy has all the settings. It's our main company, it's our master company before we created this version. So you need to go back to wherever the guy is and you can set it. So you can see because of his fixed tweet, that's why this one is not responding. So you change this one to org content. Okay, for this, we need to change it to all content, probably, sorry. So yeah, we're going to change this to what? Space between left and right. Okay, so when I'm pulling, okay, I think it's at the center and I don't want it to be at the center. So let's see. Okay, let me check the master components. So I'll put this to what, fill container. Okay, so let's see. You can see this one is now responsive. So wherever they are featuring, they are going to be very, very responsive and they'll be very good. Just toggle around your fill container, around your fill container, just toggle around it and you get some of these things very right. And you keep practicing and then you get it right. Okay. So yeah, the reason why it's like that is because it's supposed to stick to the bottom. It's supposed to stick to the bottom. Okay. And keep a space between. This one also is supposed to be fill container. Okay, so something is wrong here. All right. Okay, so more setting is going to actually warrant you to just make sure before you publish it out to your developer or something like that, make sure you check out everything, all the settings, so that I don't do that mistake. Okay. Trying to make sure that this is responsive enough. Trying to make sure this is responsive enough. Whatever is inside this thing is not supposed to be fixed. It's supposed to be filling the container. So this is what is supposed to happen. So now this is back to where it should be. Okay. Okay. Now it's very responsive. You can change this back to what, iPhone X. Okay. Yeah. So this video will be on YouTube. So what I'm going to do is that I'm going to create three versions of this. Okay. And I'm going to change this one is add. I'll change this one to cancel to call. Okay. And this one will be locate, and this one will be profile. Now I'll now go to the master component. I'll now tell the component that anytime this is clicked on, go to this place. Anytime this one is clicked, go to this place. Anytime this one is clicked, go to this place. And anytime this one is clicked, go to this place. Now, you will notice that everything in this master component, the other component has been also set. You can see this is very, very easy for you. You don't need to be dragging. Even when you keep design, if you keep design on red screen, okay, all your tabs have been fixed because of is this main guy that is controlling everything. If I didn't want to change the color of the this thing, you don't like this color, you want it to be probably this color. Everything will be set. Okay. And now, even you can even make more settings. And when this is clicked, okay, when the component is clicked, it should be, probably you could say something like it should move in, okay, it should move in from the top, okay, you could make it like maybe easy, and then that's how you set everything from your component, from your master component. Okay, this is the secondary component, this is the secondary master, but this is the main guy, the one that controls everything. So if you check some of my designs also, I design one nav, and that nav is going to be the component, and I'll make that same nav, I'll copy it, which is going to be an instance. Then that instance will be another component that we have the variants. Okay, so that when I want to do any setting on any variant, wherever they have an instance, I'll just go to the main guy, the first guy. Okay, I'll do all the settings there. Any setting I do to reflect on everything that we produce, it's just like grandfather, father, and son, that kind of thing. So anytime I need anything, I'll go to the grandfather to go and set it on my auto layouts. Everything that's what they call design system. So that anybody that wants to do any adjustment, if you want to improve your design, if you want to improve your whatever, just go to the main guy, which is where your design system is, and set them up. Adjust it, whatever you want to do. You can change, you can even change icon. If I say I don't want this icon anymore, you can change. Okay. And that is how you make very, very good design system. Okay. So any question? Any question? If you have learned something, let me know. Just type it to your group. Tell me that you've learned something new, that you've never seen this before, and this, you didn't know this is how they do it or something like. Just let me know. Let me see the reactions. All right, so please, like I said, if you check, if you check so many things I've done like that, right? Everything is from the design system that you created. So who is asking for prototype? I've done prototype now. I said all my prototype are in this guy. Okay, maybe we should play it. So let's play it. Let's give this a new flow start. Obviously, let's call it test and let's play it. Okay, so from what I designed here, I said everything. Okay, let me return this back to instance because it's going to be weird when I finish. Let's change it back to instance and I'll click. Okay, and let's make sure it preserves scroll. So that you can say all the settings I'm doing are reflecting on all these four guys because they're the one featuring on each frame. So look at this. Okay. So let's play this. So preserve scroll is that whenever that thing is clicked, wherever the page is, the position of the page, it doesn't leave that state. You understand? It doesn't leave that state. Okay, it's going to stick there. Okay, that's what it means. Let me give this a setting so it looks better. So let's go to the type setting. Use iPhone. I think I've been using iPhone X or so. Okay. So we have iPhone X. Ready to roll. Okay. So you can see if you click on here, you see how responsive it is. You can see. If your developer or your project manager tells you, please, can we see this thing on iMac? All you just have to do is click, select these three buttons, these three designs. Can see now you're not going to be redesigning any app. Just click on this and set all of them to maybe iPad mini. Okay, something is wrong here. Let me make sure all these things are fixed. Okay, from the bottom. Please stay at the bottom. Okay, I'm coming. Just give me a minute. All right. Let me set this also. Okay, so we have iPad mini. This one also iPad mini. This one also iPad mini. So you see that you don't need to design anything. All you just have to do is to switch frame. Okay, all your designs are all responsive. Okay, and then you can go to your prototype and then you can set this to iPad mini and then you go to your whatever, and it's going to be also responsive. Ready to go, ready to push. Everybody is happy. You can see, so what is going to take you another 4 weeks to redesign? Okay, constraints, resizing, components, variants, I fixed it for you. You can see how easy these things are. This is how stressless you can finish an app in just this. Okay, if you want to change all these things, maybe you want to go back and you want to use, maybe your project manager says that, or your client says he wants to see this thing on an Android, just click here and then change your prototype setting to an Android phone, maybe Pixel 8 or maybe Pixel 2. Okay, go to your prototype and it's going to be looking bang. Ready to push, ready to go. So somebody asks, when creating another screen, do you need to connect the flow to the master component again? No, if you want to create another flow, okay, I didn't get this app right. The phone, I didn't get it right. Maybe, I don't know, which Android phone do we have? How about Google Pixel 2? I don't know which one. They just wrote Android now. So. Okay, let me change it this. Those people telling me they are coming late, I'm like, don't be coming late. I hate it. Don't be coming late to this class. So if you want to connect more, let's say we have another button that we want to add. Okay, let's say we want to add, so I have cancel here. So let's say I want to add one more. And this one is going to be, this. So I can put this here. You can see how my auto layout is responsive across everything. Okay, I can delete this. I can call this one. Driver something. Let's say I have driver here. So all I just have to do is that I can set my driver. I'll just go back here. Okay, everything for my driver, everything here is going to be 30%. I'll just update it, update the design. 30% also. So this one, maybe 30% also. And this one also will be 30%. I'll just add one more variant so that we are very, very good to go. Okay. I'll just change this. This one will be 100. This one will be 30. And then I will connect this into another frame. Let's say I have another last frame here. So I'm just going to go to my variant, click here, changes to variant 5. So variant 5 is supposed to be called driver. Let me change this to driver. Don't forget that even the driver itself, the icon itself has a lot of variants in it. So I can click on fill. okay. Then I'm going to connect from here. I'm going to say anytime the driver is clicked among all the variant that we have selected, okay, always go and meet this guy. So it's going to come here instead. Okay, now we can easily click on driver, locate, profile, cancel, and add. Very responsive and good to go. Do we understand? Do we understand? Okay, so that is how simple these things are. Don't do the mistake and start. Some of you will be designing 50 screens to just to indicate one thing. And then like, just create design. If you have design system, your design system should be able to fix all these things. And that is because you've been doing it wrongly. I'm going to change this one back to. Okay, so I'm not supposed to change this one today. This one is just prototyping. Prototyping made easy. You can also check my other classes on how to make prototype. So this is supposed to make sense to you now that you have prototype. Okay, now that you have prototype in this class. Okay, move this up here. Sorry, because of OCD, I like to make sure my stuff are well arranged. All right, so you can keep up with more of this. If I have any question, please feel free to ask. If not, we'll see in another class. Okay, we'll see in another class. Thank you, guys. I appreciate all of you. Good night. So I'll upload this class tonight. So, yeah.